Affinity Photo 2 has just launched and I want to share a few of my new favourite features. Let's start with the develop persona, which now has non-destructive editing. When I open a RAW file, it opens automatically into the develop persona as it always has. And, at first glance, it seems like very little has changed. But this is good news because it means you won't need to waste time relearning how to use the software. I'll make a few adjustments to this RAW file so you can see what I mean. Let's start by increasing the exposure and adjusting the shadows. I'm also going to add a gradient overlay to the sky to reduce the brightness. Something that I do want to mention though is that the sharpening tools now seem to be working correctly. In the previous version of Affinity Photo, I needed to be at 100% magnification to see their effect. Now I can see the sharpening at any magnification and it's being applied properly to the image. Next, I'm going to apply a black and white conversion to this image. Now this is something that I usually recommend leaving until the photo persona. That's because it's applied directly to the image pixels when you exit the develop persona. Now, in Affinity Photo 2, we have the option to apply our changes as a non-destructive edit. We can still use the original pixel layer, but there are two new RAW options. One embeds the RAW file data into the image, and the other creates a link to the original RAW file. The embedded option saves as a larger file, but it's the safest option to use. It means that if the original RAW file isn't available for some reason, we can still re-edit the adjustments. With the link option, you need to maintain a link between the edited image and the original RAW file. Let's select the embedded option and develop this image. Once we have the image open in the photo persona, it looks like any other layer. But watch what happens when I double-click the layer. We go back to the develop persona and my adjustments have been saved. Now I can remove the black and white conversion from the image, which I couldn't do in the earlier version of Affinity Photo. Notice also that I now can't change the layer type. I'm locked into using the embedded RAW layer, so I don't need to worry about changing it before I click the develop button again. Non-destructive RAW editing is a fantastic enhancement to Affinity Photo 2, and it's a long needed feature. Now onto what's possibly my favourite new feature, which is the Luminosity Range Mask. It's an area where Affinity Photo has lagged behind the likes of Photoshop. Because Photoshop supports developers in developing extensions, you can purchase third-party masking tools like Lumenzia and TK Actions. Now in Affinity Photo 2, we have a new Luminosity Range Mask feature to fill this gap. To show you how it works, I've added a levels adjustment layer to this image. I've also created a rough mask to restrict the levels adjustment to the foreground. Let's say that I want to now use the levels adjustment to lighten the foreground shadows by moving the gamma slider left. This works fine, but notice the foreground doesn't look quite as attractive as it did. It's because my levels adjustment is affecting all the tones in the foreground, but I really want to restrict it to the shadows. This is where the new Luminosity Range Mask can help by targeting my adjustment onto a specific tonal range. When I click to add a new mask, I now have several choices, including the Luminosity Range Mask. If you're familiar with the Blend Ranges dialog, you will probably feel at home using the Luminosity Range Mask. The advantage the new mask has, though, is a preview option to visualize the selection. When I turn it on, I'm viewing the mask now rather than the image. The reason that it's all completely white is that everything is being selected by default. Remember, with a mask, white reveals and black conceals. The grid you see in the dialog works just like a graph. The horizontal axis represents image pixels from black on the left to white on the right. The vertical axis controls how much of a tone is included in the mask. When the point is at the top, the tone is selected at 100%. Because all the points along this line are at the maximum value, the entire mask is white. Now remember back to what I was trying to do with the levels layer. I wanted to lighten the shadows in the image, but I didn't want it to affect the other tones in this foreground. When I drag the white point down to the bottom, you can see the mask turns black in the brightest areas of the image. This then hides the levels adjustment from those areas. The mask preview is great because we can use it to visualize what's happening when we make an adjustment to this curve. Also, because this is a curve line, we can add additional points to fine-tune the selection. Then we can toggle the preview off and on to check the true effect of what's happening using the adjustment on the image. And because we have a regular mask also attached to the layer, the two are working together, so I'm only affecting the foreground. Now let's look at another of the great new features, which is the color range mask. It's like the luminosity range mask, but using color to create the mask. I'll add a new vibrance adjustment layer to this image to show you a simple example of how it works. When I increase the vibrance and saturation, you can see it affects the colors across the entire image. I'm going to push this adjustment much too far now, just so you can see the effect on the video more easily. Now I'll add a hue range mask from the new mask icon. Again, I can click the preview option to see the mask rather than the image. I can then use the color range selection points to pick a color I want to apply the adjustment to. Now you can see that it's affecting the orange in the boats. There's also a useful blur option to soften the edges of the mask, which can help to blend the adjustment you make. Even though I've added a silly amount of saturation to this image, notice that it looks better when it's limited to a specific color range. It's also possible to save presets for common color ranges like the sky. And don't forget, we can combine this with regular masks as well as combining it with the new luminance range mask. These are extremely powerful features that make editing easier, faster, and allow you to produce more natural results. Overall, I'm extremely impressed by the new Affinity Photo 2, and I've only shown you a few of the new features in this video. I hope you've enjoyed today's review of the features, but if you're new to Affinity and trying to learn how to use it, this next video will help you do just that. Thanks for watching, and I hope to see you again soon.